Welcome everybody. Thank you very much for coming along to the Communities That Care Public Forum. I'm Cameron Price, I'm the local coordinator of the program. First up, I would like to bring up Francis Brockman, the CEO of Brophy, to introduce Professor John Tumbrough.
Good afternoon, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Professor John Tumbrough. And John is the CEO of Communities That Care here in Australia. He also chairs Healthy Psychology at Deakin University and is also the co-director of the Strategic Centre for Mental Health and Wellbeing Research at Deakin University. But his influence spreads further than just his academic prowess. John changes organisations, he changes communities, and hence he changes lives. And I, for one, have witnessed this firsthand. And we were just talking just then about, when did we first meet? 1997, geez, you know. And so I first came across John back in 1997, when I was still a spring chicken in the role of the CEO of Brophy. And the Communities That Care framework just came out, and it made a lot of sense to me. And it has influenced the youth work that Brophy has been undertaking for many, many years. And the reason being was that youth services and youth work was predominantly around assessing young people at risk. And so we would assess young people at risk and then we'd say, right, now what do we do? And from there, the Communities That Care framework said, well, actually, there's this other part to it, which we all know now and we all see it's common sense. But back in the 90s, we were still very much learning this. And it was around understanding the protective factors that support young people in developing and becoming matured adults. And so these protective factors were around, you know, how strong was your relationship with individuals, with your family, with schools, and with other people in the community. And that made the difference. And there was this whole shift in the youth services area that changed from just looking at youth at risk and assessing that to more looking at what are the strengths that bring and hold young people and can support them and build their resilience. John also seeks to change community attitudes and build the capacity of communities to create local solutions to local problems. And there's two papers, John, that really caught my eye just of recent John has written John's been involved in. And one was titled, What If You Had to Get a Script from Your Doctor to Get an Alcoholic Drink? And that sort of floored me. I fell off my chair and had to sort of pick myself up again. Alcohol is a lethal toxin. And yet here in Warrnambool, we drink the equivalent to Lady Bay at high tide every year. How would a doctor justify to whom to give a script, and in which cases would it be seen as a healthy option to overcome your symptoms? We need to change the way we see the use of alcohol, and John challenges us to see things differently. And the second paper that John wrote was about young people going to schoolies week and pickling their brain for 1 week. I mean, how clever is this, you know, that for a whole week that young people actually their intake is so huge that they actually do significant damage and harm to themselves. And how has this phenomena become a rite of passage for young people when they're still in the process of fully developing. But more importantly, it's not about the young people per se, because we don't want to get into this blame game. What the challenge is for us in terms of as a community is to change our attitudes to alcohol that will then change young people's views about damaging their bodies. Communities That Care is a framework that can assist by providing the evidence, the tools, and the action we need to enact. And the person who can assist us in undertaking and understanding this approach is John and his team. So without further ado, John, could I welcome you up to the stage in Warrnambool? Thank you.
Thank you very much. So I'm really pleased to be here, and my job is not to speak very long, but basically to open it up so the team of people who are working on this project can do their stuff and start to introduce you to the framework. But I will say that my position today is I'm the professor and chair in health psychology at Deakin University. And we have actually a strong commitment from Deakin University to the Communities That Care partnership. So we're just so pleased to be working with you in Warrnambool. The Communities That Care is a not-for-profit company. It sits underneath the Royal Children's Hospital. The Royal Children's Hospital is quite an important campus. Many of us try to support it through the Good Friday appeal, and we know that we want there to be a good place where children can be looked after. But research is very important, and one of the things communities have often said to me as I go about talking to various communities is that it takes a long time to find out about the good stuff that's coming from that child health research. Communities That Care tries to shortcut that. And we do a lot of, one of our jobs in our team is to consult amongst the those who are doing really good research to bring those findings to communities much faster. And that'll be one of the things, hopefully, that we can build into Communities That Care is a way by which you can get that conduit to the information that you need. Communities That Care is has the name care in it. And it's very important, it's there for a purpose. I know that many of you do very important work and you wouldn't be here if you really didn't care. And communities, the caring part of human nature is something that is part of our potential. We know we're living in an age where we have a very wealthy nation, but sometimes we look at the way we behave and we wonder if that caring aspect of it is coming out strongly enough. Communities That Care provides a framework by which you get the potential of young people can be more strongly realised. And what we really expect is that through this framework, that innate component of it, that we are a very caring being, we're built that way, our whole immune system functions better, and we know that people get on and will do better in our society if we can bring that out. So Communities That Care gives an opportunity to get rid of some of these things that Francis has mentioned, the prevention aspect, so that we can see that flourishing and thriving that will occur in this next generation that we really need to step up and be the best we've ever seen. And we're confident it can be. My association with Warrnambool goes back to the 80s, and I could tell you that I'm very, very passionate about working in Warrnambool. So really all I'm trying to do at the moment is to say how enthusiastic we are. We're very privileged to have the support of many of the organisations you'll see listed here. I wanted to mention that the funding has come from the Victorian State Government and it's being funded under the Department of Justice, and so we're very thankful for the fact that we've been given this opportunity. So with no further ado, I'll be around if people wanted to ask me more about some of the background and some of the issues, but I'm going to throw now to Dr. Bosco Rowland, who is, again, the Deputy Chief Executive Officer, and he is working with this as part of Community Care. I might have done the wrong thing there, Cameron. That's right. And he is going to give you introduction to Communities That Care. And I think at the end there will be an opportunity for questions and answers. Anything else, Cameron, that I've missed?
No, is there anything?
Yeah. Okay, I'll throw to you then.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, it was actually me that missed something. So in my introductory remarks, I neglected to acknowledge that we are on Gunditjmara land, and I wanted to acknowledge that. and also the presence of Councillor Kyla Gaston. Welcome. I'd like to introduce Dr. Bosco Rowland. He's a registered psychologist and the Alfred Deakin Postdoctoral Fellow with the School of Psychology of Deakin University. He manages the Smart Generations, which is a trial aiming to prevent the use of alcohol by adolescents across Australia. He's worked on the Good Sports Program, which helps sports clubs manage alcohol consumption responsibly. And Dr. Rowland has published extensively on key drug and alcohol topics. Please welcome Dr. Bosco Rowland.
Thanks, Cameron. Thanks, Francis. Thanks, John. Real privilege to be in a community like Warrnambool. Every time we as a team come here, the enthusiasm is palpable and the excitement about what they want to do and change their community is really, really obvious. So it's always good to come here. It's always good to be part of the CTC team here and present on an important topic about adolescent development. So Professor Timber has already given you a brief overview of the basic background of CTC, and Francis Brakeman has given you some key concepts around what CTC is striving to do. Today, my role is really to really, well, it was flagged today through the hard work of Cameron, through lots of advertising and publicity, to really get the community here today to give them an awareness or give them an idea of what the CTC project is about in Warrnambool that was launched a couple of months ago under the, under the leadership or under the commissioning of Dennis Napthine at the Brophy Centre. So that project has started, and my role today is to really give the community a better understanding of what that's about, some of the key concepts and what you expect to see and what you'll be seeing happening in the community over the next 2 years. So we're calling this a community forum, and what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go out there on occasions because it's a bit hard for me to see. But we're calling it a community forum because it's really about engaging you, and I would hope that sometimes if you've got a question or you think you want to ask something, please do that, because it's about a dialogue that we want to do, that we want to present today. So you've already seen that. We've had the welcome from John Toombaroo. Now I'm presenting the Communities at Care, and then Cameron will present something about readiness. And that's a concept that will come up later on as we go through this presentation. So what is CTC? As John said, it's Communities at Care. Really important terms, communities that care. It's not something that has come up overnight. It's something that's been developed over time, and developed in the US by very, very important and really key players in the area of developmental psychology and social development from the University of Washington. And the two key people that have really driven the development of CTC are Professor David Hawkins and Professors Richard Catalano. Now, every so often we get Richard Catalano coming out here on a visit, and he does work with us, so we have a strong connection with the team that have developed this program in Australia. It brings together the knowledge of child development and longitudinal studies and community trials. Now, there's a lot of sort of jargon there, but what we're really trying to say is what we're talking about is getting kids on healthy trajectories. So getting and intervening at points where we think and we know that they're the most vulnerable and putting them on the best trajectory so they get the best developmental outcome. So they're going to have better success in their careers, better success at school, lower chances of being involved with drug and alcohol, lower chance of being involved with antisocial behaviour, lower chances of having depression and anxiety. And so that evidence is not gathered overnight, but it's gathered by tracking kids over time. And that's what we mean by longitudinal studies. We track them over time and we work out what are the best predictors and what are the best intervention points. So that's one way we do it. Another way is we run trials where we intervene in some areas and we don't intervene in other areas, and we see whether we get changes. And that's one of the ways that science develops. Can we prove that there's a cause and effect association? So CTC is built on longitudinal evidence and big trials that demonstrate it does work. So it began in Australia in 1998 when John was one of the seminal people involved with it, travelled over the States, and a number of other people got briefed up on what CTC is. Since then, we've began community trials in Australia in 2002. And that really leads us to where we are today, and we're now trying to implement it in about 14 communities across Australia. Evaluations show that community care system is an effective program. So CTC in Warrnambool, as John has already said, is funded from the Crime Prevention Unit, the Department of Justice and Regulation. It's supported by CTC Limited, the not-for-profit organisation, and we provide to your community technical assistance in implementing the systems and processes that you will need to develop this over a two-year period. We'll provide training and knowledge, and that all comes in a staged process. And to do it and to deliver it somewhere in any community like Warrnambool, you need an agency that's going to auspice it, that's going to be the champion and going to fly the flag for saying CTC is really integrated into this community. And you were very lucky to have Brophy Family Youth Services as your auspice agency. So in Australia, it's a partnership between the Royal Children's Hospital and a subunit in there called the Centre for Adolescent Health. And there's also a very, very prestigious research institute based at the hospital called the Murdoch Research Children's Institute, which has some very, very high-flying and prolific researchers. It's also funded by Rotary Club of Melbourne, Deakin University and the University of Washington. So what is communities that care? Well, I reckon you'll be getting your head around this for a long time, and it does take a while to get your head around it because there are lots of concepts and lots of frameworks, I suppose, that sort of knit it together. But what you need to do is get your head around some of the key concepts that I'll be presenting today. So a good way to start thinking about that is to think of CTC as a community change process. So what we're thinking about is community-level change. It's a process that benefits children and adolescents in your community. So we're intervening at the child and adolescent period. It does that by bringing stakeholders together to make joint decisions. So what we're trying to do through this process is align all your services and all your stakeholders, not to be working across purposes, but to be all pointing in the same direction and all working towards the same end. So we want to bring all the key players together, get them to think about how can you best promote healthy adolescent and child development in your community so that in 5 to 10 years, you're going to get better outcomes on all those things that I said before, things like smoking, drinking, illicit drug use, antisocial behaviour, teenage pregnancies, depression, anxiety. So we use the key stakeholders, get them to come together, work together and make decisions based on data, not based on goodwill or what people think are good ideas, but data that informs what's going on in the ground in your community. And then we work to change and promote well-being across that community. So in the long run, it prevents adolescents' problems, including school failure, substance abuse, antisocial behaviour, youth violence, and depression and anxiety. And CTC in America and the US has got evidence through all those things I said before, through longitudinal studies and randomised trials, that it can prevent these things in the long term. So one of the key concepts I've already started to talk about is prevention. So we need to know what is prevention. Sometimes we might talk about prevention as saying promoting health and well-being. Sometimes we might talk about it stopping or reducing harmful behaviours, reducing harmful effects, being proactive, so thinking in advance, how can we stop something from occurring later on? Improving health or improving social conditions. So there's lots of ways to think about prevention, but I suppose a really good way to think about it is about talking about stopping something from occurring later on. We want to intervene early so we get better outcomes in the long run. We're not treating the problem after it's occurred, we're preventing the problem from occurring. So in terms of having prevention, we need to make sure the community is ready for prevention. And Cameron will talk a little bit about readiness later on. But what do we need for effective prevention? Now, prevention's often talked about, but it's often not funded or the least funded, or often the poor relation in terms of funding. Has anybody got any idea why the government or organisations perhaps are slow to invest in prevention? Yeah. So they can't say we stopped 1,000 because why can't they say that?
Because you can't.
You can't demonstrate it, but you can reduce reductions, yes, but it's harder to demonstrate. Yeah. It's hard to quantify. We can't quantify, but it doesn't sort of tell the same story as if to say we treated so many people. It can be hard to quantify. Anything else? Sorry? It's down on the list of priorities. So sometimes community awareness, acknowledgement of the health and social issues affecting children and young people locally. People need to have an awareness of understanding of prevention. They need local champions promoting prevention. So if a community is ready for prevention, we need an awareness and they need an understanding of prevention. So sometimes communities haven't quite got that. And they need people to champion that and advocate that. So we need some sort of education and knowledge and training. We need skill building amongst individuals and the community, and CTC will help you do that. We need to establish a big plan and a coalition to bring together and align all the stakeholders, point them all in the one direction, not working at cross purposes. And we need to identify how it fits in your funding services and your current social services within your existing community. So we've all heard this, that prevention is better than cure, and it's a really nice adage, but it's often hard to implement. So these are the things that you were saying before. The results aren't immediate. The cost benefits are usually in the long term, so they don't usually fit within a government funding cycle. Highly visible responses are often preferred, so something that's got a quick fix that easily can market, has a good media bite to it. It requires long-term planning and implementation and forward thinking and commitment. So we need champions with all these ideas and can resonate with this and follow these things through. So sometimes when we think of community prevention, we think of it as all pointing towards healthy social development of children and adolescents. So we can think of doing things that implement or affect these components. So if we're thinking about prevention, we want to think about laws and enforcement. How can we create an environment that promotes healthy social development? How can we create environments in the school and the home that create healthy development? What are the norms we should be promoting in the community, in the school, in the families? What sort of education can we provide to all those people, to children, to parents, to educators, to the community? And what sort of policies are we promoting and implementing that create these environments that put our kids on better trajectories and produce better outcomes? So when we think of prevention, we're thinking of a multi-tiered approach and we're thinking of a long-term vision. So if we've got a community that's embracing these ideas, they recognise that this is a long-term plan, that it's not a short-term fix, that we need to be thinking on multiple tiers, we need to be intervening at lots of levels, working with kids, working with adolescents, working with parents, working with schools, working with health agencies, working with law enforcement, working with all the tiers in your community to prevent things occurring further on down the track. So what we're going to do is, along here, I want to show you a couple of videos that the CTC community in the States are using to help educate and promote CTC. So we've embedded a couple of videos along here in this presentation to show you some of those things and give you a bit of a snapshot. So here, this first video is going to just show you about a town that first took up CTC and some of the things they faced. I think that'll be okay. That tends to... there's an example of a community that took up the challenge of CTC. You can see that they committed to it in the long term and got changes in the long term. But they all committed and then they started to speak the language and understand the concepts and work together. So what is it that makes a CTC program in a community work? How did they get these effects in Camden? As I said before, it's founded in research. It's not founded in good ideas that people think work. It's founded in tested ideas and tested systems and tested strategies. And it adapts to your community. So it's not a helicopter drop. We're not saying, here's CTC. Okay, we're going to drop it down in Warrnambool and it's going to work in Warrnambool. The government's funding it in Warrnambool, that's okay. That job's ticked off. No, it's actually adapted. So it's a program that starts in your community and fits the contours of your community and moulds itself, but using the core structure and the core processes in the CTC framework. And it engages all parts of the community. So it's not, again, about saying, we'll give it to Brophy Services and Brophy Services are going to transform this community. Brophy Services are going to work with all the stakeholders in your community and engage them. And as you'll see later on, when we talk about how it works, there is actually a board, a community board, and there are key leaders that actually drive this process. And how it does that, it builds on local data. So we're not going to use the data from Camden. We're not going to use the data from Melbourne. We're going to use the data that's collected in Warrnambool that reflects what your kids are doing, what resources you have in your community, what are the deficits, what are the strengths, where are the risk factors, where are the kids greatest at risk, what are the things you're doing well that are protecting the kids. Develop a profile of your community and then develop a plan. So we collect local data and set priorities based on data collected here. And so what we do is we address the root problem. As I said, we're not talking about what's happened, we want to prevent it from happening. And we want to use effective evidence-based programs and strategies. So what we'll do is develop a profile, look at where the risk factors are, and as you saw in that video, one of the things that is a risk factor is low commitment to school. So what were they doing in Camden? They were implementing tutoring strategies as a way of getting kids engaged. So if kids are engaged in school, there's less chance of all those other poor outcomes occurring. So we will help you identify strategies that can target your risk factors. Now, what we're going to be encouraging you to do is using evidence-based strategies, not strategies that somebody has put together thinking that they will work and it's a good idea, but again, based on the science, has been demonstrated that they do work. So you will be only implementing strategies that have been shown to work. So that means all over, we're going to be putting multiple strategies in your community, intervening at multiple levels and getting better outcomes on all those things. And so what we're doing in the long run is we're empowering you to take control for the direction of your kids. Where do you want to see your kids in 5 to 10 years? Where do you want to see your community? So we're empowering you to use this framework and to use the evidence to get better outcomes for the city of Warrnambool. So as you've already heard me say, and you've seen on that video already, that it's based on this notion of risk and protective factors. So you'll identify what are the risk factors, what are the key things. And as I'll show later, there is a lot of evidence documenting certain things, certain modifiable risk factors that you can document, that you can intervene or reduce and reduce these outcomes. So things like school failure, substance abuse, violence, antisocial behaviour, depression, anxiety, teen pregnancies. So, risk factors are predictive of particular behaviours, but more risk factors are highly predictive also. So the greater number of risk factors, the greater the likelihood of problems. So what you want to do is reduce the risk factors and increase the protective factors. So what are risk factors? Well, as I've tried to sort of allude to earlier, is that risk factors can occur or are present at various strata of the community. So when we talk about the community, we're talking about the community of Warrnambool. We can talk about the broad community. We can talk about the environment of Warrnambool. But we can also talk about the schools. We can also talk about the family. And we can also talk about the individuals and their peers. And there are risk factors that we can identify in all those domains. And what you want to do as a community is identify the risk factors in all those domains and intervene in all those domains as many times as you can, or where is practically possible or most efficiently possible.
Given the power of social media and all its strength and good things it can do,
yep.
What does CPC have planned to, in fact, working with young people so that they're safer around using social media and the internet? Have you got evidence and data and work on that so far, or is that work in progress?
I don't think there's any evidence on social media at the moment, and the evidence that's been developed in the States is probably just before the social media bubble took off. But I suppose that is certainly an area of further research and further interest. But at this point, all I'm going to do is present to you the risk factors that has documented evidence about. Do you want to add to that, John?
Information that they're getting online as well. So if they tell you that they like school and they're connected, that part of that will be because they're enjoying the fact that they have internet access, and that, or that if they're saying that that there's very few opportunities, they'll be thinking of the fact that there's poor access and it's an issue for them. So the questions seem to be capturing the environment still accurately, even though it's changing. And certainly with the solutions, they're very actively moving into this online world. The survey is all online as well, we should mention.
So we'll get to this later, and we'll talk to the key leaders later about there are ways of identifying resources and evidence-based resources. It's using search engines and that have been set up by a link with CTC. That'll help you find programs that link into various things. So the risk factors occur at various levels of the community. So you've got the broader community, the school, the family, and the peer and individual level. So you can think of things like the community. How mobile is the community? Are people moving in and out of that community? Do people feel like it's highly transitional? Does the community feel disorganised? Do people feel like it's really fragmented, that it's not a coherent system? That the laws about getting alcohol or enforcing about getting alcohol or drinking alcohol underage, are they being enforced adequately, or do people perceive, or children and adolescents perceive, that it's really easy to get alcohol and not being charged or followed up by the police? So these are all risk factors in the community that place an adolescent or a child at risk. So we can look at things like that. At the school, at the family level, we can look at things. Is there family conflict? Are there high levels of family conflict? Do the families have poor discipline? Is there a problem of poor behaviour in the families? In the school, are there low levels of academic success? Is there low levels of commitment to school? Do kids fail at school? Are they not committed to school? Are they rebellious? Do they perceive drug use as not harmful or easily used? Are they involved with antisocial peers? Are they involved with antisocial behaviour? All these things are predictors of later developmental outcomes. And these are only just a snapshot of some of the things that you can identify at these tiers of the community. And here, while I've mentioned just a few, in terms of the CTC framework, what they then do is map the risk factors with the outcomes. Now, here's a very, very busy slide, but it's giving you an indicator. If there is a risk factor linked with a particular person or an area, you can see outcomes in these areas. So you can see at the community level, perceived availability of drugs, community laws and norms favourable to drug use. These are going to predict all these outcomes. Substance abuse, antisocial behaviour, violence. So here, family history of problem behaviour predicts all these outcomes. Academic failure in school predicts all these outcomes. Antisocial behaviour predicts all these outcomes. So if you intervene in any of these outcomes or any of these risk factors, you can reduce these outcomes in the long term. So what CTC will do is identify the prevalence of these risk factors and then map what services can be used or what programs and strategies, evidence-based programs and strategies, that have been shown to work to reduce those risk factors, which then in the end reduce those outcome behaviours. So while we might be talking about risk factors, these are things that are placing kids at risk, we can also protect or we can also buffer kids. And they're also organised around these four domains. But when we think about protective factors, we're talking about, are kids competent? Do they have skills? Are we providing them with opportunities to be involved with their communities? Are we reinforcing them when they are involved in good ways and pro-social ways in their community? And are we giving them the opportunity to bond with their community and bond with adults? And when we provide those things, when we provide those opportunities, give them the skills, give them the reinforcement, provide the bonding, then what they do is develop the standards and beliefs that you're promoting, the healthy beliefs and standards that you want, that CTC is promoting to get good developmental outcomes. Some other things that might help kids protect them from poor outcomes are high intelligence, resilient temperaments, having a general pro-social orientation, so they're interested in the community, working, putting into the community, volunteering. These things protect kids. So while we think of risk factors, we've also got to build up protective factors. So we don't always take the negative side, but also look at the positive side. So they're the broad concepts behind CTC. We're talking about developmental points, we're talking about developmental outcomes, we're talking about outcome behaviours, we're talking about risk factors. But to implement all those sorts of things and implement things like evidence-based strategies and programs, we need a sort of an overarching framework. And as your community of Warrnambool gets involved with CTC, this picture is going to become very familiar. And it has five phases: getting started, getting organised, developing a profile, creating a plan, implementing and evaluating. This is the bare bones structure of CTC. What you need to do is first get started, then get organised, develop a profile, create a plan, implement and evaluate. Warrnambool at the moment is in between these two stages, getting started and getting organised. You're just about organised to develop your profile, create a plan, implement it and evaluate it. So what is getting started? Getting started is getting local government and residents and stakeholders being a champion and being committed and saying, yes, we think we need CTC. CTC would be good for the city of Warrnambool. So there are some key players and champions that are saying, yep, CTC is good. What we now need to do is form a board and get people and get a coalition driving this at a formal level, committing funds, committing resources. So what you'll do is you'll form a board and you'll get key leaders in the community that will be the champions. So wherever they go, they'll be flying the flag of CTC. They'll be pushing the barrow for CTC. They'll be seeking funding for CTC. So what these people are, the public face in Warrnambool for CTC. And the board is the engine room that drives it. So who could be involved at that level in terms of key leaders and a community board? Well, there are lots of you here today. Local council, community health services, service groups, sports clubs, PCPs, police, chamber of commerce, schools, school-focused youth services, child and mental health services, Department of Early Education and Child Development, industry, community members, the faith community, all those people can be involved with the board and can be key leaders. They're the sorts of people that we need behind CTC, flying the flag and being part of the engine room. What are their roles? Well, they need to promote CTC in the community. As I said, they need to be the walking face of CTC. Whenever people see them, they should be identifying and they should be saying CTC. They need to provide support and assistance. They need to open doors. They need to provide access, places, resources, funding, information. So these are the really important people in your community that can help set up CTC in the long term and be sustainable. The CTC champion, we need a champion or a couple of champions that are really a key leader. That person really is influencing public policy and influencing funding. So that person really is the face. So whenever there's a media launch or something to do with CTC, that person should be synonymous with CTC. They're important for ensuring CTC becomes a fabric, a part of the fabric. So CTC is not an add-on. It doesn't something that we drop in for 2 years and then forget about. CTC is the long-term vision that is integrated. Now, like John started here in 1988 and he's back, we want to come back in 20 years or so, and CTC is well and truly established. I'm not saying we're going to leave you, but what we want to see is CTC is part of the fabric of the community. It's a long-term vision that you are investing in and investing in sustainably. So while you need some key leaders and you need some champions, you need community boards and work groups, and people like you here today can be part of that. You can be part of the community board or part of subgroups in that community board. And their role is, as I said, to be the engine room. So the community board does the work necessary to keep the CTC effort on track and moving forward. So the board, they'll attend meetings, will provide trainings and workshops that give them the relevant information and training to move through those five phases and to the indicators and the markers and the benchmarks that they can use to indicate their progress. They work together and form a common vision, and they involve and invite the key stakeholders. Overall, what they're doing is developing community support for CTC. So once you've got yourself started, you've got those champions, you've got your board together, you've got your working groups in your board, and you've got your key leaders in your community who are promoting and flying the flag for CTC and opening doors for funding and policy, what you need to do is now get your hands dirty and you need to develop your profile. Now, we're talking before about getting the evidence. It's about a locally based initiative. We want local data that will find out information of what the risk factors are in your community, what the prevalence of those behaviours are in your community, what are the resources you have in your community that can target those, what are the deficits, and what do you need to change and add to improve those outcomes and implement strategies that will target the risk factors that you as a community board and as a community want to target. What are the behaviours you want to change in the next 5, 2, 5, 10 years? And what are the risk factors that will best give you bang for your buck to get those outcomes? So to do that, you need to gather data. So what we do is, as John said, we collect data through a survey via the web by going into the schools. And we develop a survey which then will profile your community, profile the risk factors, the prevalence of the risk factors, profile the protective factors, and also we'll make an assessment, and you as a community will also help that. You will help assess what resources you have, and that information together will give you enough information to move forward in what you can do. So here's just here another link, which I'm going to get Amber to connect us to, which is just showing you how the experience of one community in terms of collecting data and using the youth survey. You just need to close that one. Information.
Yep. Halfway from beginning to the implementation, what's Well, a year, 2 years?
Well, to get through those five phases, we're working with your community to do that in 2 years. So you can do 2 to 5 years, you know, is what we've done, but in CTC in America, it's 2 years. If it's done well, implemented, well-resourced, you can do that. How are we going, Amber? You want to go to the end here? Okay. Any other questions? Yeah, down the back.
There was no mention of the kids who don't have families, don't have schools. Where do you see them fitting?
Well, no, that's right, but they might have other risk factors. I haven't listed all the risk factors there. They're just some of the risk factors. So they may have risk factors which might be related to emotional attachment, poor academic commitment, involvement with drug and alcohol, all those sorts of things, or involved with peers and friends that use drugs and alcohol. So they'll have other risk factors. They may not have that immediate family environmental risk factor, but they will have other risk factors, which will be picked up by the survey.
I would have seen them as a very major
group. Sure. I think there are 35 risk factors in the risk and protective factor profile. I've just listed a snapshot there. Oh, you mean as a subgroup?
Yes.
So it's a bit like what Kevin Haggerty's saying. Well, you can cut up a deck of cards lots of ways. The way the CTC framework's cut up is these four tiers. You ready to go?
We still consider them to have families, that they often have identified people that are functioning as carers and families, and the questions are asked in such a way that we let them sort of define that. So it doesn't mean because you've had those terrible experiences that there's not somebody who functions in your mind as a carer, that you could still rate yourself as feeling you do have opportunities to interact with those people, and that you rate that positively as a protective factor in your life. So it's still important to ask about protective factors, even if we might make the judgment that the person doesn't have a family. Mm-hmm. So, I think that this is it's still an important concept. Sometimes you can think that a family is going very well, but the child will rate that as having very high conflict and that nobody knows what they're doing. And you can get quite a shock to realise that you think that it's quite a functional situation, but not from their point of view. Ultimately, the child's perspective will be the one that will determine their outcome. We can judge from our own perspective that we think it's all going well, but if they tell us it's not, you come back 2 years later, you'll find that child will often be in a lot of trouble. So it's very important to ask them. We found that every time and again, where we study and ask parents their opinion of how the child's going, and we ask the child, and follow them up 10 years later, the child's outcome will what they said 10 years ago about the situation will predict their outcome. So if we don't listen to children through a systematic process, we're missing the central data that should be there for planning child services. And that's what Communities of Care is trying to add.
Let's give this a shot.
Example, if you give five people each a deck of cards and ask them to sort them, they'll probably do it differently. Survey allows you to have a high level of confidence in knowing about what...
So that's just an idea of what's in the survey. In terms of doing the survey, we access students through the local primary and secondary schools. So the CTC survey has different levels of the survey, so you can use it in years 6, 8 and 10, different variations for the different developmental stages. So we usually implement it in a computer lab where it has computer access. So one class period will usually be enough time for a student to fill out a survey. So as Kevin Haggerty just said on the video, what issues are covered in the report that we will use to develop a report from the data? So We will gather data from that survey and will develop a report which will show the level of alcohol use, the level of tobacco use, marijuana and other drug use, whether kids are involved in antisocial behaviour, their levels of psychological distress, and the prevalence of all the risk and protective factors that have been identified in the CTC framework. So what sort of questions can you answer, or you as a community be able to answer from the data you've collected from your youth survey? You could ask the question, is underage drinking a problem in your community? Is it the same pattern for all the ages in high school? At what age does this problem, such as drinking, seem to occur? Does it happen in key points in the developmental process? Is it during transitions from primary to secondary? Is it during the puberty years? Are kids that are using alcohol because a lot of their peers use alcohol? Where are they getting their alcohol? And what are the attitudes of their peers, and what are their attitudes of their parents? Because as we saw before, it's peers and families' attitudes that also are a risk factor. So then you can develop, or we'll develop, a profile for you which will look something like this. You can see in terms of alcohol, here we've got three bars, one for your community, one for your region, and then one for broader Victoria. So you've got a benchmark to compare what's going on in your community, in your broader region, and also the broader Victoria. And we can look at a number of outcomes. So we can say, how many kids have used alcohol in their lifetime? How many kids are current users? So how many kids have used alcohol in the last 30 days? How many kids, when they've drunk the last time, drank more than four drinks in one sitting? So you'll get data on all those sorts of things, looking at it and carving it up in different sort of ways and comparing it across different benchmarks. So there you've got it for year seven. You can then do it for year nine. Some of the things we ask about are peer influences, so things we'll ask about in the past year or 12 months, how many of your four best friends have tried alcohol? And so they can tick those sorts of things. So as I indicated before, your peers, or the number of peers that you have that use alcohol and drugs, is a risk factor. Have you got any brothers or sisters that have ever drunk alcohol? Where do you get it from? Did you buy it yourself? Or if you didn't buy it, or if you bought it, did you get it from one of these places? Or if you didn't buy it, did your parents give it to you? Did your brother or sister give it to you? Did someone buy it for you, or did you take it illegally from home? Or did you take it without your parents' permission? Or did you get someone to buy it for you by standing outside a shop, or they brought it and brought it home? It assesses parents' attitude. So does my family have clear rules about drug and alcohol? Are they fairly sort of liberal and open-ended about how drugs and alcohol are used? You know, do they not worry when you take up alcohol, or whether you take alcohol to a party, or do they provide alcohol to you? If you drank alcohol without your parents' permission, would you be caught by your parents? So kids answer on a scale which has got a big yes or a big no. And that's a good way of getting adolescents to sort of mark on a scale whether it's a really big yes or a big no, instead of putting numbers. Or they might answer on a scale which says not wrong at all, a little bit wrong, wrong or very wrong. So these are different sort of ways that we get kids to measure the degree of a response. And these are the sorts of things we might ask in terms of parents' attitudes. So here's, again, a very busy slide. Now, this is mapping some of the risk factors. Now, at the bottom, you'll see some of the risk factors and some of the ones I spoke about before. So here you can see C's and F's, and they're standing for community risk factors and family risk factors. So here, for example, is poor family management. And here is parental over control. And here is low community attachment. And again, what you've got is a prevalence figure, so how high it is in terms of percentage, in terms of your community, and then what it is in broader Victoria. So there again, you'll be able to benchmark what's going on in your community in terms of the prevalence of these risk factors. And you can break it down by year level. So here we've done it for year 7s, year 9s and year 11s. And here again, protective factors. The same thing, we've mapped it again in year 7, year 9, 11. And you can see here community factors and family factors and school factors and peer factors. So here, for example, is attachment here for year 7, year 9 and year 11. Here is emotional control, year 7, year 9, 11. So here again, you can see what's happening, looking at it, what's going on at different year levels and mapping it against what's happening in your community. So you've got a profile there. You've done the survey. You collect this data. You've identified, then you, as a board and as a community, identify what risk factors you want to target in terms of what behaviours you want to change. So you identify priorities and you create a plan and then you implement programs that target those risk factors. So you need to plan for prevention. So you ensure that the programs that you implement are evidence-based and will provide you with the resources that will help you identify what programs you can implement. You don't need to go out searching the internet or searching resources to find those things. That's all part of the CTC framework. You make decisions based on the risk and protective factors that you as a community want to target. Where are the greatest risk factors? Where are you doing well in terms of your protective factors? And then you'll combine programs which are either universal, selective or indicated. Now again, this is terminology which is some of you may be familiar with, but again, they're terminology that you'll become more and more familiar with as you become more familiar with CTC. So when we're talking about universal programs, we're talking about programs that affect the whole community. When we're talking about selected programs, we're talking about targeting a selected group, perhaps in a school or in a sports setting. Indicated are programs that kids that show a high risk are at high risk that you might implement a program. So you'll implement programs in all the tiers, but you'll also target them at a universal level, selective level and indicated level. So that's what you'll do as a community, and you'll create your action plan and then you'll develop an implementation and evidence-based evaluation. So how do we know that this is working in Australia? Well, we've run a couple of pilots in Australia and we just want to show you some of the evidence for one of our pilot communities in Mornington. We've run also a pilot in Ballarat, Bunbury and Myrtleford. This is the community in Mornington with their very happy community sign there. And they're called the Mornington Peninsula Shire. They implemented CTC. It's a very big community and, in fact, they broke down their program into 6 local area groups. But in Victoria, we saw alcohol at a roughly about a 50% level, and over this period of time we saw it go down. When CTC Mornington started, they were above the Victorian average, but over time they've trended down and are now on par or just below the Victorian average. So what we've seen in terms of ever using alcohol in Victoria, in Mornington, is now when they were above it, are now below or on par. A similar story with cannabis, but much higher. We can see cannabis use in Victoria is about here at about 3%. And when CTC started in Mornington Peninsula in 2002, they're up here at about 8%. Now, these bars, don't take any notice of, they're just confidence intervals, and I'm not going to go into what that means at this point. But just look at the middle bar. So this is trending down in terms of the state, and then what we got in CTC in Mornington, we got a rapid reduction by 2007, and then a sort of a plateauing or a similar, just a similar sort of trend in terms of between 2007 and 2012. So while they were above the state in 2004, they've come below and are almost on par now with the trend in the state. Same with tobacco use, above the state when they started, trended down and now are almost on par or equal with the state. Early initiation to sex in year 7, above the state and now again trended massive reduction in terms of trending down and are down here at almost on par with the state. They also looked at antisocial behaviour. So what do we mean when we talk about antisocial behaviour? We're talking about, are kids carrying weapons? Are they selling drugs? Are they stealing motor vehicles? Are they attacking people? Are they hurting people? Are they involved with violence and crime? So we saw a similar pattern in Mornington with that. Above the state, took a little while to start. There was sort of almost no change in between 2008, but then a reduction here and in 2012 below the state. So Mornington Peninsula, we're saying, is really one of our really good news stories in terms of what we can do in Australia. They've committed to the process over 10 years and have seen really great reductions on all those outcomes. Now the Mornington Peninsula are wanting to work on things like depression and anxiety while still maintaining investment in those things. So when we talk about CTC, we're talking about a long-term vision. We're talking about a sustainable vision and a sustainable plan. So we need to be thinking about a long-term. We start here, but we're looking in the long-term over a 4 to 10 year period. The process is you identify your risk factors, you assess your resources, you implement evaluated tested strategies. Your measurable outcomes are first a reduction in your risk factors and an increase in your protective factors. And then over time, you want to see a reduction in these behaviours and increases in positive youth development and outcomes. And overall, what we want to see in 5 to 10 years is a vibrant, healthy community. Now, you can put all this stuff into CTC, but, you know, are we getting value for money? While CTC has been evaluated, there has also been some economic analysis done for CTC. And so there's been some cost-benefit analysis recently done, and there's the publication listed down there. So it says, the recent analysis says, there's a return, this is in US dollars, a return of $5.30 on investment for every dollar that you invest in CTC around youth tobacco use and antisocial behaviour. And in the long run, that works out to be about $812 per youth in relation to just tobacco use. And overall, in terms of prevention, in terms of antisocial behaviour, you see an overall prevention of $4,438 per youth. A similar analysis is being done for alcohol, and we haven't done that, but when we get that, we'll make that available. So, that's the story, that's the framework, they're the key concepts. You've probably been overwhelmed with how it works and what it is and what are the ideas, but over time, over the next 2 years, you'll be exposed to more of this, you'll be hearing more of this. People like Cameron and Francis will be flying the flag for CTC and you'll hear these concepts. So you want to hear this again and you will hear it again through other presentations. But I hope today has given you a snapshot of what it is and what it's trying to achieve and what are the key systems and processes that CTC will be using.